In this video, I want to explain to you how genetic testing works, and specifically ancestry testing. And so I'll go through briefly what genetics is in humans and how genetic testing works. And then at the end, I want to close talking about a few cautions you might want to think about if you're considering genetic testing for yourself or for your family or friends. So to understand how genetic testing works, it's first necessary to understand humans and their migration through the world and why different human populations are genetically different and how that can be tested. So to start, we start in Africa, where the ancestor of all modern humans lived. So there's a population that was the ancestral population. So think of this as the start of the human family tree. Everybody came from this part of the world, and then they migrated. So some populations migrated south to southern Africa, where there are people like the San people, one population of humans that are in Africa. From that ancestral population, there were also migrations this direction to Australia, where we have now the Aboriginal population. And also from that same ancestral group, there was a migration across Siberia and the land bridge to Alaska, where now we have a bunch of indigenous groups like the Inuit. So for today's presentation, I'm just going to be talking about these three groups as examples of how human migration has shaped the sequences of our chromosomes and how these three groups are genetically distinct. So to move on then, we should think about what the ancestor's chromosome looked like and how it changed to become the modern San, Aboriginal, and Inuit chromosomes. What I'm about to tell you is entirely made up. They're example DNA sequences that I've created, so they don't actually reflect the real DNA sequences of these groups. So for the ancestor, let's talk about two different chromosomes. We can talk about chromosome 1, and we can talk about chromosome 2, let's say. Just two different chromosomes, for example. So on chromosome 1, the ancestor's DNA sequence might have been in part of this chromosome, CT, CTA, G, GA, C, short example. And on chromosome 2, different chromosome, a different piece of DNA, they could be CG, CT, CA. Okay. So thousands of generations ago, when humans, all humans, Homo sapiens, lived in Africa, this might have been the sequence of those parts of the chromosome. So then we can look at, as that chromosome in part of Africa, as those populations grew, generation after generation, as they moved across the world, shown here, every generation, random DNA sequence changes, mutations, occur. And so in the group moving south, that are now the modern-day San population, we might have on the same chromosomes in the same regions, CT, CTA, G, G, A, T. So it's almost identical, but there's one change right there. There was a C in the ancestral population. In that part of the chromosome, now there's a T. And we can also look at chromosome 2 and what might have happened to it. And we could say that that's CG, CT, CT, let's say. So again, one change, one difference between generations ago and the modern population. Just one sequence change out of the six that we're looking at currently. So let's look at another couple of populations. We can see what the Inuit chromosome might look like. So it could have a difference there. And a difference there. So again, most of these positions, if you were a human and if you were trying to figure out where in the world you're from, most of these nucleotides, the letters in the DNA alphabet, don't tell you anything about where in the world you're from, but a few do. So there's a difference that distinguishes Inuits from the ancestral population and the modern day San population. And we've got this position that has changed in both the San and the Inuit populations from the ancestral condition. So a C became a T as those populations migrated south. And that same C in the ancestral population changed to a different nucleotide letter, a G, as that population migrated across modern day Russia into Alaska. And again, on chromosome 2, we can see similar sorts of effects. So we have different nucleotides that have individually changed compared to the ancestral population. And that's the point here, is that this is how genetic testing can distinguish ancestry. Some of these mutations tell human geneticists where you're from, because you inherited them from your ancestors that lived in one of those particular populations. Okay. And then finally, we can look at the Aboriginal population and look at one of their chromosomes. Just again, for example. Yet more distinct nucleotide changes that will distinguish that population, in this case, two nucleotides next to each other, from the other populations. Okay. And on chromosome 2, yet another set of nucleotide changes. So you'll notice, again, important points are that some of these nucleotides are the same in all the populations. So they give us no information about where you're from. So geneticists then tend to ignore those letters in your alphabet in the genome. So we can ignore the C that tells us nothing about where you're from if we were looking at this part of your chromosome. We can ignore the T, but we might be interested in studying these sites on the chromosome where different populations are genetically different. So that's one of the important background pieces of information to have when you start thinking about how genetic testing works. So with this information in hand, then it may be easy to see how genetic testing works. First, we ignore the common or shared nucleotide sites, the C's, the T's, because who wants to sequence your DNA if it's not telling you something about who you're related to? So what we're going to do then is the testing companies where you send your cheek swab or saliva sample to, they only read the DNA at certain parts of your chromosomes, the ones we already know can distinguish different groups of people. So let's say we've got your DNA sequence. So we're only going to look at, again, because this is how the genetic testing work, I'm only going to show you the parts of your DNA sequence that get returned from the testing company. So when you get your testing back, they don't give you directly the individual letters at each position on every chromosome in your entire genome, but you can get that information, and I'll talk about that perhaps on another video. So let's say you've got ATA there, and they look at these last two sites on this chromosome, and you have an A and a T. So hopefully you're already starting to try to figure out how this information tells you something about which of these groups you might be related to. And then on this next chromosome, we've got multiple sites that were informative, but you were an A at that second site, and a G at the fourth site, and a T at this sixth letter. So we ignore all of the common letters that are common to all humans. That's why we're all humans. We're all 99.9% genetically identical. So in another important point about these nucleotide changes, these are called single nucleotide polymorphisms. That means single letter changes. And we abbreviate this SNP, S-N-P, single nucleotide polymorphism. These are these single letter changes that distinguish individual humans. And important things to know about these are that they're random, that the change from one group to another is arbitrary. You become C to T, C to A, C to G. Any letter can change into any other letter of the four-letter DNA alphabet. And they're randomly distributed across chromosomes. So although I'm showing pictures of just short pieces, 10 nucleotides or 6 nucleotides of a chromosome, or 9 nucleotides, 6 nucleotides, they're not usually this close together, these single nucleotide polymorphisms. This is just for ease of drawing on the whiteboard. So we've only got limited space, so I look at a limited number of nucleotides. Okay, so how does this tell us anything about your ancestry? The analysis of your genetic testing comes in when the geneticists at these companies that will do the testing compare your letters to the letters of all of the known human populations, not just these three. We don't have ancestral DNA, so we can't look at the ancestral sequence. But these genetic testing companies have samples of people from the San, the Inuit, the Aboriginals, and so many other human ethnic groups and populations. So if we look at for ATA, we see that the Inuit has that same sequence. So you might say that that part of your chromosome looks Inuit. This is one of the fallacies, or at least a problem with genetic testing, is that there are some of these spots, like this TA is shared because it's ancestral. It was inherited by the folks that moved south to become the San, and it's also ancestral or also inherited by the Inuit. It only changed, that T only changed to a G in the Aboriginal population. So while a genetic testing company might say this ATA makes it look like you're probably part Inuit, they can't rule out the possibility that that A came from an Aboriginal chromosome in your past, and that the TA came from somebody who was of San ancestry. So there's never a clear answer to genetic testing. It's not fact when you get your genetic testing report back. It's best guess. It's probability and statistics, most often. So here, at the end of this segment of chromosome 1, we can look for an AT, and again, we see that the A is common to two different populations, the San and the Inuit. But the T is found only in the San population. So that might lead geneticists to suggest that you have part of this chromosome looks like Inuit. Part looks like it came from somebody of San ancestry. And likewise, over here with the AGT, it's hard to distinguish then for the A and the G whether or not you might be Inuit or Aboriginal. We'll just say that that looks Aboriginal, just for the sake of argument. And then that T also could be San or Aboriginal. So at this point, there is some confusion then. There's never a clear conclusion about what the ancestry of this person might be, but there are some hints. And that's one of the reasons that when you get an ancestry test back, they don't tell you specifically, you are certainly 25% this population, 40% that population, because there is some uncertainty as to how you assign these DNA sequence differences based on what all of the human populations look like at the DNA sequence level. One of the questions that hopefully you're wondering about is, how do I have a chromosome like this example, chromosome 1, that's part Inuit, part San? So this is where it's important to understand a little bit both about how human reproduction works and also about how chromosomes evolve over time as a part of that reproductive process. So the reason that we have chromosomes that can look part one ethnic group and part the other in terms of the nucleotide or letter composition of the chromosomes is that when sperm and eggs are being produced by humans, the chromosomes are meant to and actually break and switch parts with each other. And this is a great use of It's evolutionary biology. It's a great use of molecular biology to generate diversity in humans because it scrambles a little bit the genetic code from one parent to their offspring. This, for example, is why no two siblings, even identical twins, are not exactly genetically similar, but especially non-twin siblings. They're both from the same mom and dad, usually, and yet they never look exactly the same. And that's because in your father, in his gametes, in the sperm, the chromosomes that he inherited from his two grandparents are recombining. They're breaking and swapping parts with each other, generating new combinations of your genes and your genetics. And so when a sperm and an egg fertilize from two parents, that produces a genetically unique individual, one offspring. And when the same process happens in the sperm and the egg that make the sibling, that sibling inherits different combinations of mom and dad's genes. And so this breaking process is what can break up an entire chromosome over time, generation after generation, more and more of this, every generation a chromosome rearranges itself, recombination, means that the bits of ancestry, the whole chromosomes that were inherited from you by these ancestral populations, start to break apart. And those blocks of letters that tell you where your chromosomes came from, Inuit, San, Aboriginal, get smaller and smaller every generation. And this is the information that genetic testing companies can use to determine ancestry in terms of when they say you have a 75% chance of being a third cousin of this other person who's registered with our website. This is what they're looking at, is if you're a sibling, you probably only have one recombination breakpoint in each chromosome compared to a sibling. If you are a first cousin, then you might have two breakpoints on your chromosome or more. And so all of this, again, is probability that this human geneticist at these companies work out to try to guess, infer, how closely or distantly related you are to somebody. It's not just how similar the chromosomes are, but it's also the size and the structure of these groups of letters that each show different patterns of inheritance from ancestral populations. Now, there are a couple of flaws, major flaws, with genetic testing. These are not necessarily common, but they're things you should keep in mind when you look at ancestry testing or genetic testing results. One of this is that the basis for knowing whether or not your chromosome looks like somebody that is San or Inuit or Aboriginal or Native American or Norwegian, for example, depends entirely on whose DNA these companies are using as the reference, the standard genome sequence for people of each of these populations. Now, the geneticists that have worked on these genomes of these people are pretty confident that they have what you might call colloquially a pure Aboriginal DNA sequence or pure Inuit. But there's always some probability that people have mixed ancestry but still claim that they're in one of these groups. So there has to be a little bit of caution given to interpreting, comparing and interpreting your DNA versus people of other groups. There's no perfect certain individual from any of these groups that's truly representative of the entire group. The other thing to keep in mind about genetic testing is that mutations happen all the time. They happen at random places on random chromosomes, changing random nucleotides into other ones, C's to G's, C's to A's, and so forth. So for example, here in the San population, we have a T, and you also have a T there. But that doesn't necessarily mean that that T derived, you inherited it from somebody of San ancestry. It could be, however unlikely, that your actual DNA sequence was, again, just looking at the SNPs, ignoring the common nucleotides, ATA, AA, for example. So let's say your parents had that sequence, but when you were born, when the chromosomes that made you were being generated, there was a mutation of what your parents' A was to a T. Now, all of a sudden, you might look like San, AT, or you might have Inuit ancestry, AG, somewhere in your past. So these random mutations that can happen, again, they're very rare. The probability of you having a single mutation in one of the random spots that the genetic testing companies use to look for your ancestry is really exceedingly rare. But there's the very slight chance that that could happen. So again, another thing to consider when you interpret genetic testing results. Random mutations occur. That's how we got diversity among people in the first place. And it could happen individually in you, and that could slightly skew your genetic testing and ancestry testing results.